examination of the hip joint. Well, friend, you must have heard all these things, that a thorough clinical examination is required. Most of the teachers must have told you this, but as far as I am concerned, please understand that sequence is the most essential thing. If you follow a particular sequence throughout your career, throughout your training, you will never miss a finding during the exam. So as far as I am concerned, thorough clinical examination, fine. But sequence is the single most important thing as far as I am concerned. Well, the sequence is, as you must be seeing on your screens, about inspection, palpation, movements, deformity, measurements and special tests. I'll proceed according to this plan only. Well, I'll not go into any details of the gait since Dr. Sumit already covering it. I'll simply, since it is a relevant thing, I'll simply mention these are the important gaits which are pathological gaits which happen in the hip joint disease. I'm not discussing any details, just a few seconds clips with a catch frame for everyone. Now, this is a antalgic gait. The gait with the reduced stance phase. No further discussion. I think Dr. Sumit will cover it. Cranumbar gait, lurch on the affected side when it is in the stance phase. Then short limb gait, up and down movements of the on the short limb side when it is in the stance phase. And in a short limb gait, it is not unusual to find one or two elements of pathological gaits combining. Like in this patient, it's a short limb plus Cranumbar gait. I don't think I'll discuss anything more about the gait. Now, this Cranumbar test, the Cranumbar test, sometimes it is included in the special test. But I think it's not a bad idea that before you ask the patient to lie down, to conduct this test, to make the thing simpler for the patient and for you also. Now, this is the example of a normal situation when the patient is standing on both the sides. Everything is on the level. You are supposed to examine the patient from the back, appropriately undressed. This is a child, so it is completely dressed, otherwise appropriately undressed. And you are supposed to see the level of the posterior spiliacalic spines and the gluteal folds while inspecting from behind. In a normal situation, when the patient stands on one side, the other side, posterior spiliacalic spine rises a little, and the opposite side, gluteal fold, also rises a little. This is a normal situation. What happens when there is an abductor weakness because of the hip joint disease? This is what happens. When hands on the affected side, the opposite posterior spiliacalic spine, instead of going up, it goes down because the abductors are weak on this side. The abductors are weak on the right side. So when the patient stands on the right side, the left-sided posterior spiliacalic spine, instead of going up, is going down. And the gluteal fold is also going down. Gluteal bulk or gluteal fold is also going down instead of going up. This is a classical Cranumbar sign. The next video shows you how to examine a patient with this test. As I told you already, you must examine the patient from the behind. Ask the patient to show his back towards you. Ask him to first stand on the sound limb. This is a normal situation. His left lower limb is normal. That is why the right upper limb, right gluteal fold is going up. Now, once he stands on the right side, the left gluteal fold goes down. The left superior iliac spine tends to go down and patient lurches on the right side. This is a classical Cranumbar sign. Now, there is some test called assisted Cranumbar test. If a patient is unable to stand on single leg stance, the examiner may provide him assistance to stand. Now, this patient has got a weak abductor mechanism on the right side. He is not able to stand on the right side. So, we are conducting an assisted Cranumbar test in this patient. bus is asked to stand on the normal side, which he is able to do nicely, no problem. The moment we ask him to stand on the affected side, that is the right side, he puts extra weight with the help of his left hand on the patient's right hand, upon the clinician's right hand, and only then he is able to stand. He's noticed that the patient is putting extra weight on clinician's right hand side with his left hand. This is assisted Tannenberg test. Now after we have seen the gait, we have conducted the Tannenberg test, then we come to the attitude of the limb. We are going as per the plan which I had shown you earlier. Well, one can make out that the limb may be in an abnormal position. You can see that in the first picture, the patient's right limb is in external rotation, while on the other picture, the limb is in internal rotation. So attitude of the limb should be noted by the clinician. Now, this is a typical example of attitude of the limb when there is a posterior dislocation of the hip joint. There is flexion, there is adduction and internal rotation. You can see the x-ray of the same patient with the typical attitude of the limb. Now, inspection, once you have seen the gait, you have seen the Tannenberg sign, you have noted the attitude of the patient, now come to the inspection on standing from the front. These are all the points which one is supposed to mark when examining the patient while standing from front. I'll give you a clinical example. This is a patient who has got a disease on the right side. Once you are inspecting from the front, make a note whether the head is central or not, whether both the shoulders are on the same level or not. In this patient, right anterior spiritual spine is at a lower level. Right patella is at a lower level. Please make all these observations while inspecting the patient from the front. Then you inspect the patient from the side. On the side, the things which are to be noted are what is the state of the lumbar lordosis as far as the hip joint disease is concerned. Like in this patient, there is increased lumbar lordosis and the right hip and the knee are flexed. As you notice, the patient has been adequately and decently undressed to examine. Now we go to the inspection from the back in the standing position. Once we are conducting the inspection from the back in standing position, all the points should be properly marked. The posterior spiritual spine, the spinous processes, the gluteal bulge, gluteal folds, and the back of the thigh should be visible to you. And you can make these observations. Like in this patient, the head is central, both the scapulae and the shoulder are symmetrical, right posterior spiritual spine is at a lower level. Now this was the inspection from the in the standing position. From that we go to inspection in the supine position. Like in this patient, when the patient is lying down, please make note of the level of the anterior spiritic spines on both the sides. In this patient, the right anterior spiritic spine is at a lower level, the right lower limb in the external rotation. And similarly, now you can inspect the patient from the in the lying position. When you are inspecting the patient, the lying down position, make sure that the patient is lying on a firm bed with a firm mattress. Make note of the, you must mark the anterior spiritic spine as well as the iliac crest. Make note of any exaggeration in the lumbar lordosis. Make note of the trochanteric region and the lateral thigh mass. This is summary of the inspection. I'm again repeating the points which I have covered. I have told about the gait, then attitude of the limb, then inspection from the front, from the side, from the back. This will be the summary of inspection. Now comes the palpation. Once you are inspecting, please make note of any redness, any scars, any sinuses, any muscle wasting or any ulcers. Now the different points to be covered, different steps to be done when the palpation is concerned, palpation is done. The first point doing palpation anywhere in the body or any system of the medicine is concerning tenderness. As far as the hip joint is concerned, we are concerned basically about the anterior hip joint tenderness. The hip joint tenderness anteriorly is felt or palpated just 1 centimeter below and lateral to the position of the femoral artery. Another type of tenderness which is noticed in patients of hip joint disease is about the bilateral pelvic compression test. We are doing whenever there is a disease which is affecting the central portion of the hip joint, the pelvic compression test will be positive. Now there are other uncommon sites for tenderness pathology. Tenderness in different pathologies of the hip joint. Sometimes there may be a tenderness along the origin of the adductor longus, insertion of the iliopsoas, or there may be the tenderness at the trochanteric bursa, or origin of the hamstrings may be tender at the ischial tuberosity. But basically, we are concerned with anterior hip joint tenderness and bitrochanteric pelvic compression test, which will denote central tenderness. Continuing the palpation further, always palpate the iliac fossa. You may find a cold abscess there, or sometimes in cases of protrusio acetabuli, when because of a disease, the acetabulum has protruded inside, one may be able to palpate the protruded acetabulum from the iliac fossa if the patient happens to be a thin patient. Now there is something called digital 3 finger palpation. Though Bryant didn't describe it, sometimes it is known as a digital Bryant's triangle. With the help of the three fingers, with the thumb on the anterior spherical iliac spine, the index finger on the tip of the trochanter, and the middle finger at the perpendicular going from the anterior spherical iliac spine to the floor. This is how the triangle is made, and one is supposed to make triangles on both the sides to compare. One can make out on palpation whether the trochanter has ridden up or not. You must palpate, continuing the palpation further, you must palpate the possible sites of cold abscess, which could be the base of scarpus triangle, gluteal lesion, supratrochanteric lesion, iliac fossa, which I have told you already, and anterior medial aspect of the mid-thigh. This is a summary of the palpation. The tenderness, the local temperature, the tenderness I have told you already, anterior hip joint tenderness or about the bitrochanteric compression test. You must make a note about the palpation of the trochanter, whether it is hard to touch, whether there is any roughness, or whether there is any crepitus felt during palpation of the trochanter. We have already palpated the femoral artery to locate the point of hip joint, anterior hip joint tenderness. At the same time, either this test can be done in the last, or at this juncture also you can compare the two femoral pulses and see if the hip joint you are examining, whether it has weak pulses compared to other hip joint. If the hip joint you are examining has either weak or absent femoral pulses, then Busco-Sainz on the last is positive. Then I've told you about the digital Bryant's triangle, or basically trying to palpate with the help of three fingers and trying to find out whether the trochanter has gone up or not. Then I've told you about the sites of palpating cold abscess, and of course tenderness sign we have done earlier. Now deformities, assessing the deformities in the hip joint disease is an integral part of the palpation. And to define a hip fixed deformity in the hip joint would be, a fixed deformity is defined as a position of the limb from which it cannot be brought to neutral or zero position for that axis, but further movement in that axis may be possible. For example, if the patient has got a 70 degree of flexion deformity, extension will not be possible, but it may be possible that the patient has got some more flexion beyond 70 degree. This is what is meant by a fixed deformity. Now, this is about a person who has got a hip joint which is deformed. A patient cannot walk unless the body compensates. In a case of fixed flexion deformity, the compensation occurs by increased lumbar lordosis. In abduction deformity, the compensation occurs by drop of ipsilateral anterior spherical iliac spine and lower lumbar spine scoliosis with ipsilateral climaxity. In adduction deformity, there is elevation of the ipsilateral anterior spherical iliac spine and scoliosis with contralateral climaxity. if you want to measure the exact amount of deformity, one must unmask the true degree of deformity by neutralizing these compensatory mechanisms. That is the basis of assessing deformities in the hip joint disease. Now, fixed fraction deformity can be assessed by the Thomas test. The next video will show you how to do a Thomas test correctly. The patient is lying on a hard bed with a firm mattress. One can inspect and confirm by putting the hand whether the lumbar lordosis is increased or not. Like in this patient is increased, then the opposite hip is flexed. After the hip is flexed to a certain degree, the increased lumbar lordosis starts to obliterate, and at one point it obliterates completely, like in this patient. When this happens, the hip joint goes into the flexion deformity, confirmed by pressing on the thigh whether the limb has gone to exaggerated lumbar lordosis in the exaggerated flexion deformity, and then measure the exact amount of flexion deformity as shown to you. Every step is important. Now, if you want to know what is the range of flexion in a case of fixed flexion deformity, basically, is there any flexion possible after fixed flexion deformity or not, then this is a method to do this. Please see it carefully. First, the Thomas test is done in the same manner which I have shown to you. The normal hip is flexed. The flexion deformity becomes obvious. Just press to counter for any increased flexion deformity. Measure the flexion deformity. Then with one hand holding the lower thigh, one can flex the hip further, while with the other hand, one feels the any movements of the pelvis. Once the pelvis starts moving, that is the point till which the flexion is present. So like in this patient, had a fixed flexion deformity of 60 degree or so, and is almost further flexion is possible till about 80-85 degrees. So he has a free range of about 25 degree or 20 degree of free flexion after the fixed flexion deformity. Now there is a situation called a pseudo flexion deformity. Sometimes the disease is not in the hip joint, but there is a irritating lesion in the vicinity of the hip joint, which is forcing the hip joint into pseudo flexion. Now this is a patient of a pseudo flexion deformity because of a psoas abscess. Now, how to differentiate a pseudo flexion deformity from a true flexion deformity? Please see this video carefully. In a case of pseudo flexion deformity, when the disease is not in the hip joint, the rotations will be free and painless. In this patient, rotations are free and painless. If the patient had hip joint disease, the rotations would have been painful. At the same time, in the same patient, if you try to do the Thomas test, the child cries. This is a typical example of a typical case of a pseudo flexion deformity, in which case hip rotations will be free and painless. Now, how to measure if a patient has got a bilateral flexion deformity of the hip joint, how to measure that? This is the classical method. Okay. The patient is made to lie prone on the examination table. Both the hips are flexed, which will obliterate the lumbar lordosis. Now the one hand remains on the lumbar spine, the other hand extends the hip gradually. At the point where the hip joint, the lumbar lordosis starts reappearing, is the amount of flexion deformity of that particular hip measured in this manner. The same thing is repeated on the other side. Now this method becomes sometimes impractical if the patient happens to be an adult and heavy. In that situation, I think I have described a new method of testing flexion deformity of the hip joint in cases of when there is a bilateral hip involvement. The patient is made, I think this is the, this, I have not found this method in the literature, and I feel that I'm the first person to describe it. In this patient, in this case, both the hip joints are flexed when the till the time the lumbar lordosis disappears. The one limb is held by an assistant, while the other limb is gradually extended. At certain point, the lumbar lordosis starts reappearing. One can measure the flexion deformity in this manner also. The same thing is repeated on the other side. Now, how do you measure a fixed abduction deformity? We are talking about deformities. We have seen how to measure fixed flexion deformity. We have seen what is the normal, what is the range of flexion beyond flexion deformity, and how to measure bilateral flexion deformity of the hip joint. Now we come to the adduction deformity. How do we measure the adduction deformity? As I told you earlier, we have to unmask the deformity. In a case of abduction deformity, unmasking is done in the manner shown. Now this patient has got a abduction deformity on the left side. The deformity is unmasked. The anterior sphericic spine was at a lower level. The limb is abducted till the two anterior sphericic spine become square. And then the amount of abduction deformity can be measured. Now, there is one more method of measuring abduction or adduction deformity by Kothari's angle. In the previous method, which was described by Nelson, also known as Nelson's method, we had to square the limb. While in the case, in the method described by Kothari, there is no need for squaring the pelvis. In whatever position the two anterior sphericic spines are, one line is drawn to join the two anterior sphericic spine. Then a perpendicular is drawn from the anterior sphericic spine to the midline, another from the anterior sphericic spine of the left side to the midline, as shown in the diagram. In a case of abduction deformity, this will be the and show the line joint. So above the line joining the anterior sphericic spine. So in this Kothari's method, there is no need to square the pelvis. Same principle is followed, that the anterior sphericic spine was on a higher level, the limb is moved to adduction, and the pelvis has become squared now. One can measure the deformity in this manner. So square the pelvis and measure the deformity as shown in the method.
Dr. Sudhir, please be slightly fast.
Okay, dear. A further range of adduction, the same principle as flexion and as in the flexion deformity of the hip joint, unmask the adduction deformity and see for any further possible adduction. I'll not run this video because of paucity of time. Then measure the fixed rotational deformity, which can be gauged by seeing the position of the great toe, direction of the great toe, or by this method in which two lines are drawn. One is a plumb line, another is the line which is towards the roof from the center of the patella. This is a summary of the deformities. Movements we have to see. I'll just make a mention of this Dunham sign. There have been several names for this sign. Basically, this is a sign in which this was classically described in old the slipped capital femoral epiphysis, but it's been described in now in AVN also, in which case when we flex the hip joint, at particular point the flexion stops and further flexion is possible only if the hip is taken to external rotation. Let us see. Flexion possible only if the hip is taken into external rotation. Fine. These are all the movements you are supposed to see. These are summary of the movements. Now we come to measurements. Measurement to be true measurements and the apparent measurements. Apparent measurements are in the whatever position the patient is lying. From any central point of the body, we measure till the middle malleolus without squaring the pelvis. In the tool length, we square the pelvis by, I had shown you the method already by how to square the pelvis. We square the pelvis and then measure the tool length. Like in this patient, I'll show you one example only. In a case of abduction deformity, this is the apparent length. It is measured till the limb is squared now. And the length is measured. The opposite limb, which was a normal limb, must be taken into similar degree of abduction to measure the tool length, which is being done now. Now you measure deformity. I think I'll rush through the rest of the presentation. Now this sign will tell you grossly whether there's a shortening of the limb, limb or not. I mean the patient lies supine, hip is flexed to 60 degrees in the knee, after to 90 degrees, and look for the level of the two knee joints. If there is a shortening, the affected knee joint will be at a proximal level in a case of femoral shortening. A Brand's triangle is drawn as I told you already by joining these three points, anterior iliac spine, the tip of the great trochanter and the anterior spilling and the perpendicular is drawn to the bed, and then we measure all the three limbs. Like in the, this is a patient on the right side, you can see the shortening. This is a method of measuring qualitatively, not quantitatively, qualitatively the supratrochanteric shortening with the help of the Nettles line. The patient lies on the side, the hip and the knee are flexed, and one sees the level of the trochanter, whether it is at the same level of the line joining the anterior spiral spine, the ischial tuberosity. This is a normal situation. In a case with a supratrochanteric, this is another method of seeing whether there is a Shoemaker's line, whether the supratrochanteric shortening or no, not the line. Line joining the tip of great trochanter anterior spilix line is spilix spine is extended further to the midline. If there is a supratrochanteric shortening, this line, these two lines will intersect on the opposite side and below the umbilicus. I think I'll leave this. These are summary of the measurements. These are the special tests. I'll not tell you the details. Only two tests are important. This is a telescoping test. If the hip is unstable, this is how the telescoping test is done. And this is about how to measure the hip antiversion. This is the last slide. You want to see whether what is the antiversion of the hip joint. The patient is lying supine. The hip is extended and the knee is flexed. In that position, hold from the ankle with one hand, while the other hand palpates the trochanter. Find the position of the limb in which the trochanter is most prominent. In that most prominent position of the trochanter, measure the angle made by axis of the tibia with the perpendicular. This is the angle of antiversion. I think I'll finish here. In the last one, must make a note of the lymphadenopathy and the contralateral hip and knee joint. I think I'll finish here. And basically, this I've given you a glimpse of what is the full presentation of the hip joint disease. If anybody is interested, then this is my book is available by CVS Publishing.